Gallipoli. Silent now where the sea ran red with the blood of men so courageous, we are left humbled when we read of their actions. Where soldiers walked onto their deaths over the bodies of their fallen comrades. Where, as so often during the Great War, countless brave lives were senselessly thrown away. Gallipoli, one campaign too many that began with slaughter and ended with defeat. From this end of the historical telescope, the Gallipoli campaign of the Great War appears to be another instance of brave men sent to die in waves for an ill-conceived theory. The war on the Western Front in France had choked itself to a standstill in the mud. The strategic and tactical ideas of the commanders had apparently suffered a similar fate. It was the first Lord of the Admiralty, Winston Churchill, who came up with a plan to attack the Gallipoli Peninsula.
The overall plan was to knock Turkey out of the war. Germany had drawn Turkey into the war as her ally, and this had caused problems for the Western allies, for Britain, France and Russia. Turkey had threatened the Suez Canal, had closed the Dardanelles, which cutting Russia off from her warm water ports, and also threatened our oil interests around Basra and Abadan. So the idea was that if we could send a force through the Dardanelles and threaten Constantinople, the Turkish capital, Turkey might capitulate. That, in turn, might open the way for an Allied advance from the southeast. The war in France had degenerated into a trench deadlock. Nothing was happening there. But there was still a situation where the Westerners, such as Kitchener, saw the war in France as the, or saw France as the main theatre, France and Belgium, as the main theatre in which we win the war. The Easterners, such as Churchill, thought that an outflanking movement might help.
The plan to open up the Dardanelles, initially through naval bombardment alone, was lame from the outset. Doomed by reluctance to commit men and equipment in the quantities required, and gaining only grudging support from commanders like Kitchener, who refused to send promised troops once the campaign had begun. On the 19th of February 1915, a naval bombardment of the forts along the Dardanelles signaled the start of the campaign. The intention was to silence the guns in these forts, then sail in closer and bombard gun emplacements further inland in preparation for the landing of demolition parties. Even at this early stage, the plan went wrong. The flat trajectory of the naval shelling failed to destroy either the bulk of the forts or their defenders. The Turks simply waited for the guns to cease firing and then came from under cover and fired back. To add to the difficulties, mines had been laid by the Turks in the waters around the peninsula. Churchill became increasingly irate at the lack of progress. He wrote, "This work has to be done, whatever the loss of life and small craft, and the sooner it is done, the better."
Churchill was the first Lord of the Admiralty from 1911 until May 1915. He was an Easterner. He believed that an attack on the Dardanelles, or attack on Turkey through the Dardanelles, was a worthwhile venture. He was actually flying in the face of perceived wisdom, because in 1906 there had been a report by the General Staff which concluded that an attack on Turkey via the Dardanelles was unlikely to succeed, even an amphibious attack using the Army and the Navy. Now, Churchill was so confident of success that he even allowed Kitchener to deprive him of the army element of the attack until it was too late, and he alone felt that a naval attack could succeed.
One decision that helped to put Gallipoli firmly amongst the tragic, romantic battles of history was made at Kitchener's suggestion after he reneged on his decision to spare the 29th Brigade for duty in the East, a decision he later rescinded. Churchill objected, but the Australians and New Zealand troops gathering in Egypt for transportation to the Western Front were to be sent instead to Gallipoli in support of the Navy should a landing be required. These combined forces, the Australian and New Zealand Army Corps, came to be known under the acronym Anzac, which was also the name given to that part of the peninsula where the troops fought. Their commander was to be Lieutenant General Sir William Birdwood, and he soon disagreed with Kitchener's view that if troops were required, they would perform only a minor role. In his opinion, the Navy alone could not force the Dardanelles. Lamentably, he was proved to be right. Birdwood was not chosen by Kitchener as Commander-in-Chief of Operations. Instead, General Sir Ian Hamilton was appointed.
Hamilton, if anything, suffered from one great failing. He was too much of a gentleman. He was beloved by people who served with him, not just liked. He was amusing, witty, genial, and very good company. But he had not got the steel in him to sack useless subordinates. And above all, he was too much infused with the general staff concept, which had been adopted a few years before for the first time in the British Army, which held, in the words of Helmut von Moltke, the Prussian who really first devised it, that the commander-in-chief, after issuing his initial operational instructions and formulating his plan, must leave thereafter the conduct of the battle to his subordinates. And this is exactly what Hamilton did at Gallipoli, as it turned out, with dire results.
The inadequacy of the minesweeping operation was brutally displayed when the French ship, the Bouvet, was sunk by mines on the 18th of March, with the loss of all but 21 men from a total of 700. Even Churchill was forced to agree that an opposed landing was now inevitable to enable the mines to be effectively cleared.
What really happened was that initially the campaign had been conceived as a naval-only campaign, and when after the 18th of March it was realised that the Navy would not be able to carry it out on their own, suddenly the need for a military invasion arose. Now, this had not really been foreseen, so this resulted in a number of problems. Primarily, the force that had been sent out from England had not been sent out in a way that was immediately ready to carry out an invasion against the defended shore, so that any transports coming out had to be completely reorganised. The size of the force itself was very small still, and the parts of it, the component parts, were spread quite randomly around the length of the Mediterranean, right from Gibraltar through to the eastern end. And so obviously they all had to be collected together, and in fact Kitchener had specifically stated that they must be collected before any operation began. What they had decided to do was to make two simultaneous landings at Cape Helles, on the very southern tip of the peninsula. The British 29th Division were to land and force their way up towards the Killet Bar Plateau, which really protected the defences that the Navy were trying to bypass. At the same time, the Australians and New Zealanders would land near Garba Tepe and push in toward the northern flank of the Killet Bar Plateau, and so that you would get this simultaneous pincer attack, which hopefully would drive the Turks from the plateau, and then from the plateau, the British and Australian forces would have complete domination of the Dardanelles.
Landings would take place on five beaches at Helles, named S, V, W, X, and Y, and one at Anzac, north of Garba Tepe, named Z. To detract the Turks from the main assaults, a feigned landing by the French was to take place at Boulair. Later, it was decided to make additional landings of French troops at Cum Cale to prevent the Turks from firing into the backs of the soldiers at Sed El Bar. The troops were to be landed by tows, small boats drawn close to the shore by picket boats or steamers. It was also agreed that at Helles, a collier, the River Clyde, was to be run aground with troops of the first wave, enabling them to pour out of the holds through four specially made doors and reach the beaches more swiftly. One young man of 27 was spared the agony that was soon to engulf the men he was hoping so fervently to fight alongside. Rupert Brooke died of blood poisoning on a French hospital ship one day before he was to embark on what he had described as the ambition of my life, a military expedition against Constantinople. In the early hours of April the 25th, a bright moon lit the waters around Gallipoli as Irishmen, Australians, New Zealanders, the French and the British silently filled the tows and waited for the order that would send them across the waves to hell and death. The 3rd Australian Brigade bobbed around in their tows on a sea smooth as a mirror, 2.5 miles out from Garba Tepe, as the darkness intensified. At 0300 hours, a megaphone order ripped the silence. The landings were underway. The men packed solidly in their boats were mocked by events from the beginning. The tows began to bunch and lose their positions, and the landing order became completely disrupted. This was a disaster from which the expedition never recovered. Shortly before 4:30 a.m., the first troops, part of the 9th Battalion, were on shore. Just as the men were running from the boats, the Turks opened up with their machine guns, rifles, and shrapnel shells. With the arrival of the first wave of troops, the carnage was also underway.
We got our instructions before we left Lemnos that we weren't to fire a shot. We had to take the Turkish positions and trenches at the point of a bayonet. And we were each given an armlet, a white armlet to wear, pinned to one of our arms. The order was that if we saw anyone without an armlet in the dark, we were to bayonet them. This is one of the biggest blunders we made. It made us a fine target for the Turks in the dark. I remember the lighter going out with a load of about 5 men. A few minutes later it returned, full of our lads badly wounded. We had to wade to the shore, me carrying a Vickers machine gun on my shoulders. And when I got near the beach, I fell over a tripwire that the Turks had put in the sea exactly for that purpose. Nearly all the rifles were useless anyway once they'd been in the seawater. The shore was thick with dead and wounded. There were dozens of blokes there who never got up out of the water.
For the Turks, the landings could not have been more to their advantage if they had planned them themselves. Many of the men, sitting static in their tows, were killed before they got into the sea. Others, jumping into deep water, lost their backpacks, rifles, spades and ammunition. Once on the beaches, officers and NCOs became separated from their men. The soldiers, some sensibly ignoring orders to form into platoons under the withering firestorm, made a push inland as fast as they could. But by now, the second wave of the attack was landing in correct formation and adding to the confusion. Remarkably, despite this, casualties were not as severe as it had first seemed.
We advanced, acting in reserve to troops which were assaulting the Turkish trenches. But it being, of course, daylight, we were exposed to the enemy guns. We trudged forward for over 2.5 miles, over a mile of which was shrapnel fire. Shells falling all around us, men falling in every direction. While over his head, good old ironclads pumped shell after shell back in answer. Many of the wounded had crawled under those bushes, thinking in a frenzy of pain that they'd afford protection. Instead, they were found burned to death, sometimes past all recognition.
But the nightmare had just begun. And before the end of the day, the majority of the hospital ships were filled with the wounded. But they had been commanded to stay in place for 48 hours, and injuries became putrefied before adequate surgery could be obtained. At a place called Fisherman's Hut, north of Anzac Cove, the Australian 2nd Brigade was being devastated by Turkish fire, forcing troops to land further south on the Anzac Cove. Naval beachmasters and military landing officers inexplicably did not come ashore until 10 a.m., leaving men dispersed along wide areas without proper orders. No artillery had been landed either. Indicative of the chaos was the battle for the hill known as Baby 700. It changed hands five times that day, with Australian and New Zealand troops mingling by accident, finally being regained by the Turks. By the time the day was drawing to a close, the Anzac landings had claimed over 2,000 Allied casualties. The Turks, too, had suffered greatly and fought with valor and tenacity. Their efficiency took the Allied commanders by surprise. Turkish commanders were proud of their men. One of them was Mustafa Kemal Bey, later to become known as Ataturk, father of the Turks.
Mustafa Kemal was a commander of the 19th Division in Gallipoli. He was a career soldier. He graduated from the Staff College about 1905. He'd fought in Libya during the war with Italy, and also fought in the Balkan Wars. So he was quite an experienced soldier by the time he got to Gallipoli. It has been said that he was the man behind the Turkish resolve. He stiffened the resistance, and even Lehman von Sanders, the German commander, after the war commented on Mustafa Kemal's qualities as a leader and as a fighting soldier. He prevented the Anzacs from making any headway during the April landings, and also managed to put a stop to the Suvla Bay landings in August 1915.
At Helles, where the initial assault was launched without a preparatory naval bombardment, S and Y beaches were successfully taken. 63 casualties were counted on S Beach and none on Y. At about 0600 hours, the tows approached W Beach. And when they were only 50 yards from the shore, the Turkish guns let rip. Men were ordered into water that was too deep and drowned under the weight of their equipment. Machine gun fire massacred the men in the boats, and only two of the 24 tows reached the shore. As the soldiers had been denied covers for their rifles, these became waterlogged or filled with sand, useless to the desperate men who had survived the merciless hail of fire, only to be left prostrate and defenseless on the shore. By 0730 hours, however, the tenacity of the men had enabled them to establish and hold a front line around the beach. On V Beach, a catastrophe was in the making. Here, the Dublin Fusiliers, the Munster Fusiliers, the Lancashire Fusiliers and the Hampshire Regiment were intended to form a body of some 2,800 men. At 0600 hours, the Dubliners on their tows and the steamer, the River Clyde, began their approach to the beach. But the currents thwarted the plan to land the Dubliners first, and the River Clyde suddenly grounded ahead of them. 300 of the 700 men floated to their deaths in the tows as the Turks raked the Irishmen with vicious machine gun fire. But for a small bank offering meager cover 10 yards from the shore, the annihilation would have been absolute. The men in the River Clyde looked on horrified at the bloody spectacle being played out yards away from them. Worse was to come. The Munsters received the orders to disembark. They died as they walked down the gangplanks into the hail of bullets. Once in the water, having left the cover of the small ships that protected them, they were relentlessly mown down with no chance to defend themselves, yet no order was given to stop the advance and end the carnage. As so often in the Great War, the inability of commanders to withdraw men from insane, indefensible positions resulted in obscene waste of life. The sea was red with blood and filled with corpses.
The actual landings quite soon ran the course. They became exhausted really by the end of the 25th, 26th of April. And the positions that the troops, both at Garba Tepe, where the Australians landed, later known as Anzac, and at Cape Helles, were very poor. They found themselves really pinned into narrow areas of small beachheads, and it was desperately important that they try to move themselves forward. Now, at Helles, this resulted in a series of exchanges from really about the 26th, 27th of April forward through to the end of the second week of May. At each stage, what the British there were trying to do was move their line forward towards the village of Krithia. Now, Krithia lay on the lower slopes of the hill of Achibaba, which became the initial objective and had been set as the initial objective for the 25th of April. So the first point that they needed to do was reach this hill so that they would have elbow room, effectively, to unload, reorganise and move forward from that position. Unfortunately, what happened there, and the same thing really happened at Anzac, was that at each time, stage where they tried to move forward, the British troops met reinforced Turkish defences. The British had a very limited number of troops to make the landing, really insufficient. What they needed was a second wave of troops to move through those that had made the beachhead and then carry on the momentum through over the next few days. They were not available.
By now, Kitchener seemed to want to extricate his troops from the impasse at Gallipoli, but knew it was politically impossible to do so. While the politicians squabbled, the soldiers dug in and died. At Anzac, the Turks were brought up as close as possible to the Anzac lines. These were not continuous, and the horrendous situation for the men was nowhere more apparent than at Quinn's Post, where 5 yards to the rear of the Allied trench, there was a vertical drop, and a few feet to the front were the Turkish trenches. Nevertheless, by the middle of May, the Turks had suffered 14,000 casualties at the hands of the Anzacs. On the 19th of May, the Turks made an attempt to break the stalemate with a massive assault, and the number of wounded or dead Turks, some 10,000 in all, shows the magnitude of the attack. Next day, the stench from corpses rotting under the burning sun in no man's land added to the hardship of trench life. A 9-hour armistice was arranged by Kemal Bey between Hamilton and the German commander in charge of the Turkish defense of the Dardanelles, Otto Liemann von Sanders, to allow for the burial of the fallen.
Von Sanders, or Liemann von Sanders, to give him his proper name, was a superb soldier. He'd been discarded for high command in the Prussian army and was probably disappointed that he had not been given a corps in Europe so that he could fight the French or the Russians. But he found his true métier as the commander in Turkey of this great army, which he really created with his men. One only needs to look at his face to see that this is a masterful, cultured, calm, honest, straightforward man, a sort of man who anybody would count it a privilege to serve under. And the Turks soon found that he was a very hard taskmaster, but well worth serving.
There was one last full-scale attack by the Turks at Anzac on the 29th of June. After that, trench warfare, with its endless digging and instant death by sniper's bullet for the unwary, was the norm, bringing boredom and sapping energy. At Helles, the overall situation was no better. Fighting was continuous up until the 8th of May.
We reached the first line, but there wasn't a Turk in it. They'd cleared for their lives. The rifle fire became much less, but instead there was an awful tornado of shrapnel which could enfilade us and bombard the seashore, as they unmercifully did. We made a sort of irregular line in places 3 or 4 deep and chased the Turks out of the next 2 trenches. We dared not fire because our own men in front of us threw the irregular advance. The very nature of the ground made it impossible to get into anything like a line and charge, but we went on. There was then a commencement of rifle fire from both sides. I had never imagined that rifle fire could make so fearful and so everlasting a roar.
Three large-scale assaults by the Allies gained very little ground. And by the end of the attack off the 12th of July, there had been 12,500 casualties. 7,700 of those were British. Scenes such as those where garbled orders sent men onto the attack across the ground between their own interlinked lines, where they were killed without any purpose, continued to bedevil the campaign. The assault to take Achi Baba raged over 3 days and caused 6,500 Allied losses alone for the sake of an advance in the trench line of 600 yards.
The failure of the British General Staff to anticipate the extent of the Turkish resistance is, I think, one of the main indictments of the way the campaign was conducted. It was the total failure on behalf of both Hamilton and the members of his General Staff to realise that the Turks would stand and fight. There were reasons for this. Over the previous years in the Balkan Wars in North Africa, the Turks had performed very badly. They had been defeated, in fact routed, you could almost say, in the Balkans. And when General Lehman von Sanders was sent to take over the military mission in 1912, they really did need complete reorganisation so that their army was not in a good state. And this was fundamentally the reason why the British failed to anticipate how good they would be. The early part of the First World War itself, they had performed moderately, but in Mesopotamia the British had pushed them back, and it was only really as plans began for a landing that the Turks again began to show more mettle in Mesopotamia, so that there was this underlying belief that the Turks would not stand and fight on the beaches, but in fact they did. And I think the main reason why that they did this is that they were defending their homeland, and it was tremendously important for them that they should stand on their own ground and fight anybody who tried to invade and come against them. And the clearest parallel you can come up with in this is the reaction of the British in 1940 at the Battle of Britain, which ironically, if you think of Churchill's famous speeches about fight them on the beaches, everything he said that we should do in 1940, the Turks did in 1915 against the British troops.
The hardship wrought upon the men who were sacrificing their lives, often for no good reason, was intensified by the scandalous lack of forward planning by their superior officers.
During these last days, our losses have been very heavy, and a number of our men have been taken bad with dysentery and enteric fever. The smell of the bodies is becoming intolerable. When a man is killed in the trenches, all we can do is throw him up onto the top of the parapet and leave him until we can spare the time to bury him. Our numbers have been so much cut down that there are not enough fit men for the reserves, with the result that we have had to do our 24 hours in the firing line, 8 hours in the supports, and 16 hours pick and shovel. That makes only 8 hours sleep out of 48, and the condition of the men after a fortnight of this can well be imagined. Many of them broke down completely and had to be sent away. If we aren't relieved soon, there will hardly be a man left to hold the place, for not one amongst us is even fit enough to stand.
Conditions for the men were appalling. With the main base over 800 miles distant in Alexandria, the provision of supplies was a major problem never satisfactorily resolved. There were no stores or warehouses, and all supplies from the ships were delivered under constant fire. Mules were used to transport the provisions to the front lines, and the Zion Mule Corps had the unenviable task of walking the same paths that were well known to the Turkish snipers. Rations were stolen at every stage, and the frontline men had a staple diet of corned beef, tea, and army biscuits.
Conditions for the troops on the peninsula were appalling. Everywhere, I mean, there was tremendous heat. For a start, everywhere there were flies, and the flies fed on the corpses. The bodies, because of the nature of the fighting and the nature of the terrain, very difficult to recover bodies that were killed and lying out in no man's land. The flies fed on the corpses and then contaminated the men's food. The men in turn got dysentery, and then the flies fed again on the excrement, which in turn contaminated the men's food even more. So the disease was rife. People had running sores. Apart from dysentery, there were malaria and paratyphoid. So the fighting forces on Gallipoli very, very soon lost their efficiency. Yeah. There was obviously a terrible shortage of water. Everything had to be brought onto the peninsula from the Greek mainland. Shortage of water, shortage of food, or variety of food. The soldiers lived mainly on bully beef and biscuits, and in that sort of heat, the bully beef degenerated into a liquid. The biscuits were absolutely rock hard. I think I've seen some fragments of biscuit that were brought back from the peninsula in the 1970s by somebody who visited the battlefield. Now, they hadn't been eaten by the wildlife on the peninsula, so how could the troops eat them?
Desertion was hardly a possibility at Gallipoli, but suicide or self-inflicted wounds were, and some of the young soldiers were tempted by either option. Throughout the summer, Hellas had seen most of the fighting, but Hamilton was convinced that the best chance to break the deadlock existed at Anzac. His confidence was not backed up by general clarity of purpose and commitment by anyone else, however. Once it had been decided to start an offensive on the Anzac shores, the stage was set for another spectacular failure, through no fault of the brave men who fought to their last breath under commanders, many of whom did little to deserve their gallant loyalty. The tragedy of the Suvla Bay assault is one of the awful milestones in military history. Hamilton realized that excellent commanders in the field were essential, an obvious fact that seemed to escape Kitchener, whose obstinacy resulted in a well-respected but retired officer, Lieutenant General Sir Frederick Stopford, being put in command. A choice that had the effects Hamilton so rightly feared, but did little to avert. To compound the woeful inadequacy of preparation, Kitchener refused to supply any more howitzers to the Gallipoli forces, vital weapons to support trench attacks. Paranoid secrecy even denied the battalions knowledge of their part in a full-scale assault on the very night it was to take place, thus depriving them of vital preparation.
The reaction, certainly in Great Britain, to the events as they unfolded at Gallipoli was very mixed. It took quite some time for the full implications of what was going on to come through. Gallipoli was a long way off. Mail took a long time to come back. Mail was censored. So that the only real impressions that were gained would be from the newspaper reports, and the newspaper reports were necessarily very upbeat about what had been going on, even though they were not necessarily like that in the actual circumstances. But people at home did start to get reports of what had been happening. And I think many people would have been very surprised that we were involved in this area, having seen perhaps the naval involvement, and then found that there was this military campaign undertaken. They would have been, I think, disappointed at the very slow pace of progress. And as more and more troops were drawn into the campaign, people would obviously become increasingly worried that this was becoming a danger spot within the war. But nevertheless, some of the troops who went out to fight in August had read press reports, Sir Ian Hamilton's dispatches, the dispatches of Ellis Asmund Bartlett, the main British newspaper correspondent, describing the landings in April and the subsequent battles. And this still managed to maintain an aura of romanticism, so that at least some of the troops going out, part of Kitchener's new army, into battle for the first time, were not as fearful, perhaps, as they subsequently became, as the conditions of life became better known in this country. As that became better known and the August defeat came about, I think that people in this country became more fearful, certainly, of it as a destination for their husbands, sons and brothers to go to.
On August the 6th, 1915, an assault on Hellas, either side of Krithia Nulla, began. Its aim was diversionary, to prevent Turkish troops from being brought up to reinforce the defences at Anzac. It failed.
We arrived at the outpost to which we'd been directed, losing three or four men on the way. We were wounded and feeling pretty tired. Besides 80 pounds of gear, we had to carry boxes of ammunition as well. Another regiment were making their way down the valley, and we met at this point, Everyone trying to get out of the way of the shrapnel. And at the same time, an indescribable mix occurred. The Turks were making the fire even hotter, and I don't know how I escaped being hit. Men were falling all around me, and the Irishman got fairly mad with excitement. How we finally extricated ourselves from the melee, I don't know, but we managed it somehow. We were almost up to the firing line, and the sight that presented itself is just one I should never forget. There were dead and wounded lying everywhere. And the wounded were so numerous that it had been impossible to cope with them all. And many had lain there for days.
As before, the opening bombardment was ineffective. And when, after an hour and a half, the infantry went into action, actually reaching the Turkish front line, the counterattacks were brutal and overwhelming. 2,000 casualties within 1 hour, and not an inch of ground gained. Later that day, Lieutenant Guy Geddes refused to send his men to certain death, disobeying orders to do so. A commendable and courageous act. Lehman von Sanders was confirmed in his opinion of the secure nature of his Hellas defences and ordered troops to Anzac. The whole enterprise at Krithia had been another useless waste of time and life. Further to the north, at Lone Pine, another diversion had been ordered. The Australian 1st Division had been assigned to a task that was filled with unspeakable horror. The Turkish trenches were reinforced with roofs of heavy logs, and the Australian trenches ran to within 30 yards of them. From these, at 5:30 in the afternoon, the 1st Division poured out under murderous Turkish fire to dash for the enemy front lines. For 2 days, the two sides slaughtered one another with bullets and bayonets in the trenches and tunnels, blood-stained success finally going to the Australians.
I think their role is, particularly the Australian infantry, is best summed up by the comment of an unknown British officer who saw them in action and said that the Australian infantryman is the bravest thing God put on this earth. That really describes the tremendous dash of the Australians and the New Zealanders in battle. Why did they perform with such verve? I suppose basically because of their way of life at home. These were all men, almost entirely men of British stock. Over 30% had actually been born in the British Isles and had emigrated. When the call for volunteers for the Imperial Force, the Australian Imperial Force, went out in September 1914, there was a rush to join because the recruiting poster said, free trip to Europe and 7 and 6 a day. So they said, whoopee, we can go and see the family again and fight the Hun in Flanders, etc. But they were taken off the boats, of course, in Egypt on Churchill's instructions because there was a threat to the Suez Canal from the Palestine direction, the Turks. And also because Churchill was already beginning to think about getting troops together for an expeditionary force to capture Constantinople. Now, the way of life in Australia was free and easy. They were not a biddable, herd-like society, such as the British volunteers who flocked loyally to join up in the autumn of 1914. The Australian was accustomed, and the New Zealander too, to living life independently, not in the herd. So they were quite difficult to bring under collective command, if you like. They were extremely fit. They were aggressive. They had a tremendous sense of community and matiness. They stuck by their mates through thick and thin. They appeared to British conventional officers in Alexandria and Cairo to be an undisciplined mob because they didn't salute very readily. They behaved raucously because they'd been let off the leash for the first time in their lives. They were new to a new world, if you like. But they were terrific fighting material.
Further north still at the Neck, Australians had once more been mindlessly sent on a run to their deaths, ordered by incompetent British officers to attack straight into the massive firepower of the Turks. None of them stood a chance of survival.
In every case, attacks were ordered rather lightheartedly and carried out without method. The men on the spot are not listened to when they point out steps to be taken before entering on a special task. The Turks have sited their trenches very cleverly, and it's often useless to attack one set before another has been taken. The Turks dig in like moles and prepare line after line for defence, seven or eight behind the other. The great difficulty is in making attacks and supporting them. The trenches become congested, the telephone wires get cut by shrapnel, and the whole show gets out of control. Almost always, the attacks are made by men in the trenches and not by fresh troops. The men are kept too long and too thick in the trenches. They become stupefied after 5 days. It all seems very amateur, but I suppose it can't be helped. The idea is always to get through with a rush and to disregard losses.
Everywhere, the attacking troops met with a ferocious fire of the Turks, and at the end of the 7th of August, it was clear that the objective set, the capture of the Sari Bear Ridge, had not been achieved. By the end of the 8th of August, Mustafa Kemal was in charge of the Turkish defences at Anzac and had planned his first counterattack for 0430 hours the following morning. Although his attack failed to dislodge the Allied troops, the increasing strength of his defenders meant that Anzac troops were rewarded with little success throughout the entire operation. On the 10th, a second vast Turkish counteroffensive swept into the loyal North Lancashires and Wiltshires, and a massacre followed. The old story had been repeated. Lack of food and water, battalions scattered and jumbled, no effective command. The simultaneous landings at Suvla Bay met with equally merciless resistance and with the same appalling effect. Here again, carbon copies of previous mistakes were made as boats strayed out of position, field reports failed to materialize, bombardments were ineffective, and only warned the Turks of an imminent attack. And Hamilton did not take a decisive grip on the situation. The results had a terrible inevitability about them.
The 10th Irish, the 11th and the 13th were wildly enthusiastic, fired by patriotism, but horribly inexperienced for the sort of warfare they're now plunged into. They'd been training for 6 months to go to France for trench warfare. They were flung ashore, initially at night, on a strange shore, without maps, without prismatic compasses, led by young, brave officers who had no military experience other than the officers' training corps of their grammar schools and public schools, and under generals who were just not up to it, and who had never commanded anything except British regulars and Indian troops, and had no idea whatsoever what to expect and what to ask of citizen troops. There was no water for them. They had no water other than what was in their water bottles. They were short of ammunition, except what they were carrying. They were short of medical supplies. There were no ambulances. It was an absolute catastrophe. And the generals just blundered around. They failed to press on. And it was 36 hours before anything really happened. And when the first of these units reached the high ground, which they are supposed to have reached in 12 hours, the Turks had beaten them to it by 20 minutes, and it was by 20 minutes that that campaign was lost. Thereafter, Suvla just became a nightmare, and the later battles were horrendous. The scrub caught fire, incinerating the wounded who were lying there, and people to their dying days would remember the crackling of the flames and the screams of the wounded men and the explosions as the ammunition in their pouches exploded as the flames engulfed them. It was just a nightmare. And one whole company of the Norfolks, the 5th Norfolks, recruited from the King's Sandringham estate, disappeared without a trace. Their bodies were not found till 1918, deep inside the Turkish lines, where they had fought to the end.
On the 21st of August, the battle for Gallipoli was effectively over. The probability and extreme difficulties of a winter campaign began to focus minds in London on ending the stalemate by a full-scale evacuation. Hamilton was greatly angered by such talk and replied that if evacuation was to take place, then losses as high as 50% should be taken into account. He was relieved of his command of the Mediterranean Expeditionary Force on the 15th of October.
Once the evacuation had been ordered by the early part of December, the plans were very much in place, and they began over a period of 10 days to run down the stores even more. They began to take down the number of men to what they regarded as the minimum that they could really manage with if the evacuation got held up by the weather. And so they took away, in order to preserve the appearance of normality, they began things like taking away piles of boxes from inside and leaving the shell of the boxes at exactly the same size. They left tents up even though they were empty. They left piles of things there. Empty ration wagons would take rations up to the line even though there was nobody there, so that everything would continue apparently as normal. And then eventually they got down to the point where over two nights they would remove the remainder of the force, but had they been stuck there, they would judge to have been sufficient to continue to defend themselves. On those two nights, the first lot were taken away, and then the same size batch were taken away on the second night at both Anzac and Suvla, and this plan was put into effect very successfully. And in fact, bar the normal number of casualties that took place on any night, no specific casualties were attributed to the evacuation.
As a last act of indecision, the remaining troops had been cruelly left to languish in the trench filth in unbearable extremes of stifling heat and freezing snow for 5 months after the end of the ultimate Gallipoli battle. Not until the 28th of December did the new chief of the Imperial General Staff receive confirmation that Hellas could now be evacuated as well.
The enemy was exceptionally quiet, a fact that aroused suspicions. Each of his men was given a card showing the exact timetable and a map for his departure en route. Heavy weather began to threaten and a strong wind started to blow. The night air had become freezing and our small band of watchers had neither overcoats nor blankets left to warm us. It seemed incredible to us that the evacuation was actually in progress behind us. So silent were all the movements. During the last few days, many of us had visited graves of comrades for a last long look, a tear, or a prayer. Then there began an anxious time. For over 4 long hours, about 50 of us held a front that should have been held by more than a brigade. The stillness could be felt. On the other nights, we'd been able to walk through the trenches and yarn and smoke with mates, but now long stretches were deserted. 2 tablets of morphine were to be placed under the tongue of a casualty before leaving him, but things would have had to be very serious indeed for anyone to leave a wounded mate behind. The last 10 minutes seemed even longer. We listened to our watches to see if they were still ticking. 5 men where a brigade should be. Now a few shots are cracking in the distance. Stunted shrubs look like enemies creeping towards us. We've dropped down into a trench. And now, at last, it's our turn to go.
This operation was accomplished without loss of life. And by the 8th of January 1916, all Allied troops, wearing sandbag cloth around their feet to dampen sound, had left the peninsula. The campaign that had begun with a half-hearted bombardment ended with a whisper. Only the troops deserved any acclaim for their actions. But the price they had paid was obscenely high.
I am the enemy you killed, my friend. I knew you in this dark, for so you frowned yesterday through me as you jabbed and killed. I parried, but my hands were loath and cold. Let us sleep now.